We now must move on to questions for the Minister. Thank you. We must now move on to questions to the Minister for Health. I call Jonathan Bell, who is not in his place. I call Iarraim Sir Philip McGuigan, who is not in his place. I call Tom Buchanan, who is in his place.
Question number three.
Since 2013-14, the HSB has provided funding for a pilot condition management programme in the Northern Trust with specialist knowledge and expertise in helping people diagnosed with ME. As part of this, ME patients, as recommended by NICE, were placed on supported self-management programmes specifically adapted to take into account their unique needs, which offers lifestyle advice and coping techniques in a 12-session programme. The pilot was successful and is now funded recurrently. A similar model is in place within Belfast Trust. The Health and Social Care Board is presently working to recruit a regional medical lead for ME, and when successful, they will consider how best to deliver the specialist ME knowledge and expertise across all remaining health and social care trusts.
I call Mr. Buchanan for a supplementary.
Thank the Minister for her response, but would the Minister not agree with me that Northern Ireland needs a specialist consultant in this particular field, given the number of people that are now suffering from ME, and would she take some steps to consider bringing forward someone of that calibre for this specialist condition?
I think it's important in terms of taking decisions for the way forward that we evaluate what has been done. So obviously the pilot's going to feed into the evaluation and allow us to actually assess what's required. But suffice to say that the board are currently working to recruit a regional medical lead. So I think that will be, I suppose, will answer the question that you're asking. I think it's important that we consider continue to support those people with ME. And we've seen some recent investment over the last number of years. And I think it's important that we continue to build on the good work that's there, but also that we continue to work in the spirit of our delivering together a new way of working and making sure that we're designing services that are fit for purpose and meet the needs of those people who suffer with ME. And I think as part of that service, how we design those services is important that we listen to patients, and we listen to carers, their families, and we also listen to the staff that are providing the services in the front line.
I call Joanne Dobson.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Now that the ice is finally beginning to thaw around support for services for people suffering from chronic illnesses such as ME, what guarantees then will the Minister give that those charities who are fighting so hard will be fully involved in their design and delivery?
Minister.
Well, I'm not sure what the member is talking about in relation to the ice beginning to thaw, but in relation to getting services right and making sure we involve patients and carers and families and service deliverers in how we design services is absolutely at the core of the new way forward. The strategic direction, which I've set out very clearly, puts the needs of the patients at the centre of the decision making, and I think that's going to be really important for people to feel ownership and understand why things are done in a certain way. Also to be part of actually designing the care pathway, which they obviously will need to use. So I think that in terms of going forward, it's very much a patient-centred, it's very much a service-centred, it's very much about delivering better health outcomes. But in order for us to be successful in doing all that, then we need to listen to everybody's voice.
Iarraim Sir Pat Sheehan.
I've got a free last concorda. Could the Minister tell us what condition management programmes are offered to ME patients?
Yeah, all health and social care trusts offer condition management programmes to help participants with a range of health problems to better understand and manage their conditions. Only Belfast and Northern Trusts offer specialist programmes for ME patients. These are 12-week voluntary work-focused programmes to help participants with a range of health problems to understand and to manage their condition, become engaged in more meaningful activity, and also to return to work or training either now or in the future. Some examples of condition management programme sessions are around problem management, assertiveness, building confidence and self-esteem, healthy lifestyle, getting a good night's sleep, stress management, managing low mood and depression, fatigue management, anxiety management, pain management, back care, and what's next after CMP. The programmes themselves receive funding by the Department of Communities also, and it's targeted at persons with a variety of long-term health problems and primarily those that are in receipt of health-related benefits.
Iarraim Sir Mark Durkin, I call Mark Durkin.
I've got a free old ask, the Minister just touched on it at the end of her answer there. I'd like to ask the Minister what ongoing engagement she has with the Minister for Communities regarding the improvement or improving the condition management programme?
Yeah, I mean, as I just said in the previous answer, that the Department of Communities obviously funds those whole areas of work which I set out, and I think that's really important. And I think in terms of going forward with a new style programme for government, very much outcomes focus is going to allow us actually to work collectively a lot more. And I think that you'll see in terms of the programme for government how each department needs to interact with each other. We don't have the luxury of working in silos, we have to work together. So for me, I'm very, very key about the need to coordinate, to collaborate, to make sure we design services and we support people, whether that be within the health sector itself, working in conjunction with the community and voluntary sector. And I think that obviously myself and the Department of Communities will have a lot of overlap in terms of how we can support people better, and I'm looking forward to that.
I call Paula Bradshaw.
Thank you, Minister. Can I ask you to go back to your original statement around the recruitment for the regional medical lead for the Belfast Trust? And given that it's been months that they have been trying to recruit this to no avail, I'm wondering, could you comment on what your department's doing to try and address that issue?
Well, as a member of the Health Committee, we'll be very aware there's recruitment difficulties right across the piece, and it's very difficult to recruit into posts, but we have to keep trying. We can't just say we didn't be successful one time and then give up. So we're going to have to headhunt people where it's necessary. We have to do absolutely everything we can to attract the right clinicians in to support the population here. So I'm assured that the board, in conjunction with the Trust, are doing absolutely everything they can to make sure we recruit someone into that. And I'm very happy to update the House in relation to the progress in relation to that over the future. But I think it's important that we establish this regional medical lead, and I think that will allow us to, to give confidence to those patients that there is a regional oversight, that there is one medical lead, and that is going to filter right across no matter where you live in the north.
I call Alan Chambers.
Question 4.
My department has set the following targets, which set out reasonable timescales for the discharge of patients from hospital, namely that 90% of complex charges from an acute hospital take place within 48 hours, that no complex discharge should take more than 7 days, and finally, that all non-complex discharges from an acute hospital take place within 6 hours. There were a total of 32,288 discharges from the Ulster Hospital in the 12 months from the 1st of August 2015 until the 31st of July 2016. Of these, 4,443 did not meet the targets. The HSCB and the PHA Regional Unscheduled Care Team has developed a number of work streams to support improvements in patient flow, and has been working with the South Eastern Trust to put in place structures and systems to ensure that discharges occur as soon as medical advice allows, to maximise the efficient use of hospital beds and deliver the best use of resources to patients. The pressures on the health and social care system that contribute to delays in discharging patients from hospitals are further evidence of the need to transform the way we deliver our services. And that is why the vision for future health and social care services that I have set out in Health and Wellbeing 2016, Delivering Together, places patients at the centre of service delivery and seeks to reform community and hospital services so that they are organised to provide care when and where it is needed.
I call
Alan Chambers for Deputy Speaker. Minister, you previously told me last year there were over 17,000 days of discharge delays at the Ulster Hospital, which is an astronomical figure. Can you detail what extra steps your department and the neighbouring trusts have actually taken to improve the provision of social care places outside of the hospital setting? And will the information revealed by today's RQIA report have any bearing or influence on the urgency by which you are going to look at the obvious problem of the delayed discharges in the Ulster Hospital?
Thank you. Remind the member that questions shouldn't be read, and it's one question, so the Minister can choose to answer which question.
Well, in relation to the RQA report, which has been published, and that was the result of an inspection that was carried out in the Ulster Hospital during a 4-day period back in February of this year. The report of that inspection obviously has been published today, and the Trust now have an obligation to submit a formal quality improvement plan to RQIA to set out how they're going to address the recommendations that have been made, and also to set out the timescales for the completion of any actions. I think it's important to note that whilst there are a number of recommendations that must be addressed by the Trust, inspectors did not find any issues that required escalation to either Trust or to the Department, so I think that's important. And also to say that since the inspection was held in February of this year, there's been a number of areas where there has been improvement already implemented, so it's not that the Trust were sitting back and waiting for the report to be published today. They've already been very active in doing whatever they can in relation to dealing with the issues which have been highlighted within the inspection. I am lucky enough to have the opportunity to go to the Ulster Hospital last week and actually shadow an ED nurse. And for me, Those people are absolutely amazing, and under such pressure, they're working day and daily to support patients. And their enthusiasm, even though they have all those challenges, their enthusiasm was brilliant to see, and their commitment, their dedication over and above. And they were telling stories about how, whenever under pressure at winter times, how staff come in just out of their own time, they come in and to help out. I just think that is testimony to the healthcare staff that we have. So whilst there's lessons to be learned within the RQAA report, and the Trust will obviously set out their plan for how they're doing that, I'm confident that they have been working continuously since their inspection to improve where they could improve in advance of the report being published.
I call Gordon Dunn.
Principal Deputy Speaker, and thank the Minister for her answers. I think, first of all, we would welcome the investment. A considerable investment there has been at the Ulster Hospital, at the ongoing programme there, which is amazing. We really do recognise
the progress
that's
been made. Can the
member
come to his question, please?
Following on from the RQAA report, and the Minister already mentioned, in relation to staff shortages, do you recognise the need to address the issue of junior doctors and other staff, particularly at the weekends and during night duty?
Yes, I mean, I think that the Ulster Hospital is actually one of those hospitals which, if you look at the increase in the number of patients they've seen in the last year, it's significant year on year over the last number of years. I think it's actually maybe the largest increase we've seen in any trust area. So that shows the pressure they're under. So combine that with an ageing population, people coming presenting with more complex needs, obviously leads to all the challenges which they have. The workforce issues are considerable right across the whole of all trust areas, which is why we need to have our proper workforce plan and why we have to actually have a targeted plan as to how we're going to attract more junior doctors, how we're going to attract the right staff to work in the right areas at the right time. So some of the advancements around advanced nurse practitioners, how can we use other professionals also to complement the whole team? And that's something that the board and the trust are obviously working on in relation to the Ulster Hospital itself. But I think that in terms of the challenges which there are within the Ulster Hospital, I have to commend them for the work that they've been doing all year, and I have to commend them for the improvements which they've made since the inspection, and they'll continue to do more, and they'll continue to make sure they have first-class services for those people that present and need their services.
Éireann Sir Sinead Bradley. I call Sinead Bradley.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Does the Minister accept that a large number of the delayed discharges are due to the fact that there is insufficient staff and resources within community care packages? And could she tell this House what direct impact she's planning on dealing with that matter?
I think that there are a range of reasons for delayed discharge, and that can include complex reasons, and I suppose if you were to list them out, you would say there's issues in relation to no capacity with domiciliary care providers, no residential home or nursing home or AMA beds available. You could maybe perhaps people with difficult conditions needing more complex conditions, needing essential equipment, maybe adaptations not complete to their homes. You could no inpatient-based palliative care arrangements, no home community-based palliative care arrangements are not enough. Not always enough suitable step-down beds available. These are all, I think, a combination of factors which sometimes make it difficult for why people are, why there's reasons for delayed discharge. But if we're going to try and help and improve the whole system, when I talk about the future, we talk about whole system transformation, and these things obviously are going to be key parts, because if it's not right in the community, it's going to have an impact on how people can be discharged from hospital. So I think we'll have to come at it holistically, and that's the plan that we've set out in relation to delivering together, how we're going to change that whole piece, because if we can't concentrate on one element of the system, every other part of the system has a knock-on effect.
Éireann Sir Catherine Seely. I call Catherine Seely.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her answer so far. The Minister has outlined some of the complexities around discharge. Could the Minister outline some of the actions that are being taken to reduce discharge delays?
The Trust is continuing to work to address all those pressures which I've outlined, and they're working really, really hard to improve patient flow through the hospital and into the community. And over the past number of years, the Trust have been working closely with the Board, other Trusts also, GPs, and the South Eastern Locality Network to develop services in response to pressures on acute services. A number of initiatives have been introduced to help improve flow and provide services in the community to assist hospital discharge in the North Down area or to avoid admission. That includes things like new discharge models such as the Integrated Discharge Hub, Discharge to Access Model, Domiciliary Referral Hub and a Discharge Lounge. Full utilisation of intermediate care beds, development of an enhanced care at home model which provides higher intensity care at home for older people, home from hospital domiciliary care pilot, enhanced fall service and partnership with the ambulance service, additional clinical staffing to manage periods of peak demand within the emergency department and across the whole hospital site, additional multidisciplinary staff support including extended weekend and evening pharmacy, diagnostics, social work and allied health professionals, and multidisciplinary teams established to expedite the discharge of people with complex needs. So I recognise that there are a number of pressures within domiciliary care and the wider support system, and that's why we're going to bring forward in March of next year the reform of adult social care, which is currently being developed in proposals for a reform to ensure that we have an effective and sustainable system of care and support in the future. As outlined in my vision, I'm committed to ensuring that I consult on these reform proposals in March, April of next year.
I call Trevor Clark.
Question 5.
The mileage rates are not set by me. They are set by the management and staff side representatives from England, Scotland and the North of Ireland in partnership through the NHS Staff Council. The Council reviews the rates twice a year based on the motoring costs that are published by the AA in order that they can be moved up or down in line with the current motoring costs. All HSE employees are reimbursed for miles travelled in performance of their duties, which are in excess of the home to agreed work base return journey. Normally, the miles eligible for reimbursement are those travelled from the agreed workbase and back. The current rate of reimbursement for privately owned cars is 56 pence per mile, up to 3,500 annual miles, and 20 pence per mile thereafter.
Trevor Clark for supplementary.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer and say I'm putting record in disappointment. The Minister wouldn't actually meet me to discuss this issue. But given some of those, particularly those in the crisis team, are travelling well in excess of 10,000 miles per year, which drops them to 20 pence per mile, would the Minister not agree that it's actually unfortunate that those who are working in that difficult circumstances, covering most parts of Northern Ireland, are actually subsidising the health service by the use of their own cars?
I thank the Member for his question. And I have that many requests for meetings I couldn't possibly meet everybody, but I did give consideration to your letter. I know you did write to me in relation to the issue at some stage in the past. I mean, I think that it's important that staff are supported. It's really important that they're supported to do their job well, and that was at the key in terms of delivering together and how we're going to go forward. We have to support our staff. They're the biggest asset of the health service. In relation to the policy around the mileage, it's not something that I set, so I could give a consideration if it's something that I set, but perhaps if we had that power devolved here and that was in my capability, then I could do something about it. I think that I know the member has raised the issue. He's very concerned about rural workers, and I think that's a very legitimate concern. I won't be found wanting in terms of my support for those staff. If there's ever an opportunity for me to feed into the policy development, but obviously how it's currently set with AA setting the rates, then it's difficult to step outside that. It's also not something that I'm being lobbied about from unions, for example, who are part of the staff side negotiation. But listen, let's keep it under review. I want to do everything I can to support the staff out there who do excellent work, and I do particularly understand the challenges for those people who work and look after people in rural areas.
Éirim Saoire, Linda Dillon. I call Linda Dillon.
Could the Minister advise when the last review was carried out?
In line with the collective agreement, a review of mileage rates was conducted in November 2015 using AA information on fuel prices over a 12-month period ending in October 2015. And it was found at that time that fuel price changes were insufficient to trigger a change in the mileage rates, as there was no change to the mileage rates in use across the HSE. It was not possible for a review to be carried out in May of 2016 as intended, as the AA had not published updated information on fuel costs. As an interim measure, the NHS Staff Council put forward a proposal that if there is a change in rates following the next review in November 2016, this month, the change would not be backdated, avoiding the need for either the recovery of overpayments if the rates go down or the calculation of arrears of reimbursement should rates go up. The HSE Joint Negotiation Forum's Executive Committee agreed this proposal at their 25th of July meeting of this year.
Éirim Saoire, Patsy McLone. I call Patsy McLone.
Gorm Agad, Frio Lascion Corlia, I guess Muihus Lascion Iras and Fragri. Thanks very much, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I thank the Minister for our answers. Could I ask the Minister, it was referred to earlier there, around discharges and part of the problem for discharges being the lack of available domiciliary care provider packages. Can I ask the Minister what input she has to ensure consistency of terms and conditions of employment, including mileage, within that particular sector, that independent domiciliary care provider sector? which is leading to problems with discharges.
I mean, I agree with the member in relation to the previous question, where we highlighted some of the problems in relation to discharges or in relation to not being able to secure proper domiciliary care packages. The member will also know that I have on many occasions in this House said that I think that domiciliary care workers are the backbone of the health service, and that they are predominantly a female workforce. They are the lowest paid in the health service, and where they're paying their mileage on top out of their wages are even coming down even further. So there's a review of domiciliary care, which I'm about to take receipt of, and I look forward to delving into that, because I personally believe that these domiciliary care workers, we should have more people in-house employed in the health service. Because what we're having to do is we have a relationship with the independent sector where, let's face it, the majority of domiciliary care workers are employed, and quite often those people do not receive mileage, and that leads to problems as to why we can't recruit people again back to the, particularly in rural areas, so people can't go out because they're already on no wage, and then the cost of mileage is obviously bringing that down further. So I think we can do more. So along with the domiciliary care review, alongside the review of adult social care review, which we'll have next year, I want to see a change in picture where we do have more domiciliary care workers employed within trusts. As far as possible, we should be employing the majority of them. For financial reasons, that may not be possible, but I certainly would want to change the current picture in relation to the majority being outside the health service and the minority being inside the health service.
I call Philip Smith. Éireann Sir Philip
Smith. Speaker, I thank the Minister for her clarification around mileage rates for domiciliary care staff, and I welcome the fact that a review is underway. But could I ask the Minister to confirm that she is supportive of domiciliary care staff receiving mileage payments and being reimbursed for it, and to confirm that she has lobbied hard on what she has put in place to ensure that contractors are forced to reimburse their staff fairly?
I'm in constant conversation with the Finance Minister just in relation to procurement and how we can actually secure better terms and conditions where we have to go out into the independent sector. So I think that if we're going to be serious about supporting the lowest paid workers in our society, then we should make sure that when we're procuring services that we actually do them a fair service and do them justice by making sure it's part of those contracts. Obviously, we're in a difficult financial situation, and the fact that domiciliary care provision, I would say, at times can be fragile. We need to make sure that we do it in a proper and planned way. But I absolutely am supportive of domiciliary care workers being supported and receiving a fair wage for the work that they do.
Éireann Sir Claire Hannah. I call Claire Hannah.
Neither the Health and Social Care Board nor the Belfast Trust has any current plans for major primary and community care infrastructure developments in South Belfast which require consultation. The Health and Social Care Board is aware that a number of GP practices in South Belfast have been approached by a developer who intends to redevelop the King's Hall site at Balmoral. Some GP practices have expressed verbally an interest in moving to the new site, but to date only one proposal has actually been submitted to the HSCB to relocate. The extent of consultation required by the HSCB will depend on how many practices make an application to relocate. If further proposals are received from other GP practices in the South Belfast area, this is likely to impact more greatly than the relocation of one practice, and therefore additional consultation would be likely. This process would include seeking the views of patients and local communities through letters to patients and focus groups to assess impact, including in relation to Section 75 groups, and understand issues and how to mitigate them.
Claire Hannah for a supplementary.
Thank the Minister for her answer. She will be aware of the proposals for a major private healthcare park in South Belfast. Your department hasn't had contact with that developer, and would she agree with me that a population plan will be required to make any reasonable decision on that proposal?
Minister.
Yeah. I personally haven't any engagement with any private providers. I obviously am aware of the situation, and I am aware that one GP has actually expressed an interest to want to go. But if you're going to have a whole-scale move to that site, I think it's really important that we consult people, that people understand and are on board and think it's the right thing to do. If we're going to plan services together, then we'll have to have that consultation. The patient voice needs to be heard. I think local elected representatives' voice needs to be heard. I think everybody needs to be part of the conversation moving forward. So, as I said, only to this to this day, only one GP has actually expressed an interest to actually want to relocate. It's obviously a decision for the others, but they would have to obviously come through a consultation process. They will have to approach the board. So I don't envisage that anything will happen in a haphazard way. It would have to be a planned, managed change if there was going to be that change.
I call Gary Middleton.
Principal Deputy Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for her answer so far. Can the Minister outline whether she plans to follow through on the previous Minister's plans for the Health and Social Care Board?
I can, and I have said that the board will close, but I want to do that in such a way that staff are informed and brought along with the journey. I think that there are opportunities for us to actually streamline how we do things. Very much in terms of the direction of travel moving forward, I set out that the Delivering Together was all about changing systems, but there are some structures which needed to change, and the board was obviously one of those, and there was plenty of consultation in relation to that. So the board will close, and I think what I'm intending to do over the next number of weeks is actually engage directly with the board staff about what's going to go where. But I think that there are two things. I think that we need to have a strong focus on performance management and on financial issues, but then also alongside that, we need to have a regional oversight. So what that looks like, I think we could elaborate on the work that the PHA does and actually incorporate it there. But I want to talk to staff first. I think I owe them the courtesy to talk about their futures and where they're going to be moving to. They have, I suppose, for some time been sitting in a bit of limbo waiting to see what happens next. So I want to talk to them, but I'll keep the Health Committee informed in relation to what happens next. But certainly it's my intention to immediately move on that and talk to the board staff and bring them up to speed.
Éirim Sir Declan Kearney. I call Declan Kearney.
Gur mhaith ar a phríomh leas concúrla agus míle buíthe statia ar a sacht na freagraithe go dtí seo. Minister, what other primary care infrastructure projects do you have in place at this point?
As well as the pilot projects in Lisburn and Newry, the new centre at OMA is progressing really well. This is part of the OMA local hospital project, which had an overall capital investment of $85 million. The new health and care centre opened in Banbridge in January of this year at a capital cost of $16.5 million, and a new $25 million health and care centre opened in Ballymena in February of this year also. Both these schemes were funded by traditional capital. Whilst work on the development of business cases for new projects has been temporarily paused pending the evaluation of Lisburn and Newry projects, the Health and Social Care Board has commenced work on the preparation of a regional services needs analysis for respective trusts, local commissioning group areas, which will inform decisions regarding the future infrastructure requirements that are going to be within each area.
Éirim Sir Barry McElduff. I call Barry McElduff.
Question number 7, Cash Dibbleshot.
The main opportunity for further All-Ireland collaboration is in the delivery of health services rests in the total size of the population on the island. Increasingly, medical specialities require relatively large population groups in order to meet clinical standards that require higher numbers of procedures to be carried out by clinicians in order to deliver better health outcomes for patients. So when we combine when we look at the population across this island, it's clear that we have a sustainable population base on which to provide many of these specialist services. In addition, the opportunity to combine north-south investment means that we can better afford new health service developments. For example, we have committed together over $100 million to deliver children's congenital heart disease services through an all-island network and radiotherapy services in Derry for cancer patients from the northwest. My department has carried out initial scoping of further opportunities that allows us to build on the current work programme to deliver better health and wellbeing outcomes for people across Ireland. I intend to discuss these further opportunities with Minister Harris at our next North-South Health and Food Safety Sector meeting, which is actually tomorrow. Our initial scoping has identified opportunities for collaborative working in specialities such as human organ transplantation, services for people who have rare diseases, the emerging field of genomic medicine, a networked approach to major trauma, and in mental health, particularly in respect of perinatal mental health, eating disorder services, and services for children and young people. I want to commend the substantial work that has been done by the health authorities north and south to date and state my commitment to support them to take their efforts to the next level. At the heart of this collaboration is putting the interests of patients first and foremost by delivering safe, high-quality health services which will provide mutual benefits for patients north and south.
Barry McElduff for a brief supplementary.
Yeah, thanks very much, Principal Deputy Speaker. Can I ask the Minister if she and her department are identifying potential new areas for north-south cooperation in this matter?
And a brief answer from the Minister?
Yes, I can. And tomorrow I'll look forward to speaking with Minister Harris in relation to that. But yes, I've set out some of the really good work that's already happened, but I think there's so much more scope, so much more opportunity, particularly in relation to mental health, perinatal mental health, particularly in relation to children and young people's services. And I think that the scope there, and I'm very happy that whenever Minister Harris and myself agree a formal programme in relation to scoping out these areas, that I would give an update to this House in relation to the work that we're going to take forward.
Deputy Principal Speaker, I thank the Minister for her answer so far. Could the Minister update the House on the future of the South West Acute Hospital in Enniskillen, especially in relation to acute services, stroke services and the future recruitment of staff?
I think that the South West Hospital, obviously, firstly to put on record, my thanks to the staff, the wonderful staff that actually provide brilliant services every day, and I know that the management in the department, Western Trust, and all the agencies involved are working really, really hard to make sure we develop services. In terms of some of the areas where I think that in relation to the direction of travel and going forward, we're looking at, there's so much scope there, I think, in relation to South West Hospital. I think transformation, service transformation, is going to provide major opportunities for South West Hospital. I think that we're all aware of the challenges which we have in relation to the South West Area Hospital and in relation to recruitment and retention. And those are challenges which we have to address, but that's why we're going to do the piece of work around workforce planning. I think there's also great opportunities in relation to the fact that the University of Ulster have now produced their strategic outline business case, which is looking at proposals to create a new medical school in the North West. So I think all those things combined together mean that there's a positive picture for the future of the South West Area Hospital.
Supplementary for Richie McPhillips.
Thanks to the Minister for her answers so far. The Minister will be aware of a letter sent by herself to the Chief Executive of Fomalanoma Council that states that she cannot force junior doctors to, and I quote, locations that are unpopular due to geographical remoteness, that have weak training experience,
please,
and lack of supportive environment. Can the Minister clarify these comments, in which she accepts that they will be seen by many as pre-empting the closure of acute services in SWA?
Well, the short answer would be no. And I think that it's unhelpful, to say the least, that the member tries to grab a cheap headline in his local papers for 1 week, which puts in or lets staff feel that their jobs are in jeopardy in the future, that makes patients feel that their services are going to be in jeopardy in the future, whenever very clearly transformation points to the need to specialise. It very clearly points to the need that there are points to the fact that there are opportunities for the South West Hospital, not indeed the former, which the member has suggested is going to be the case. So I suggest a wee bit of positivity. I suggest a wee bit of support for the staff that work really, really, really hard. And I think it's really, really unhelpful to take the approach for a cheap headline that you have taken. In terms of going forward, I've set out some of the areas where I think that there are real potential. The fact that we're going to have the University of Ulster looking towards developing a medical school in the area shows that there's a commitment to the long-term future of attracting staff into that area. There are, of course, challenges in relation to attracting staff into the area. That's been known for many, many years, but there's a workforce issue right across the piece. So let's look at other ways. Just because one way that was suggested isn't the way I think we need to go, doesn't mean there's not other ways to do it. So the fact that a training school up there would mean that, because evidence shows that actually medical staff will stay where they've trained. There's a body of evidence that shows that. So that shows that if we do all these things and we actually are positive and we actually work in partnership and that we actually support the medical staff, the highly trained and dedicated medical staff, clinicians, all those people up there that work, instead of getting cheap headlines, the people of that area would be better served.
Question number two has been withdrawn. I call Roy Beggs.
The Northern Ireland Audit Office has also published a report today into emergency hospital administration, and it indicated that some 1,700 patients remained in hospital for more than a week than when they were ready for home. And it also highlighted that Antrim Hospital had only 37% of patients who were not, sorry, as much as 37% of patients who were not seen within 4 hours. So can the Minister advise how delayed discharge is adversely affecting our hospitals and our A&Es, and what is she doing about it?
I think I answered that question during question time, but I will just comment in relation to the delayed discharges, the fact that we have had the audit office report that has been published today, and it clearly sets out the figures which the member referred to. I think the most common reason for delayed discharges vary by each trust, so different reasons in different trust areas. For all the, I've set them out previously in relation to capacity and domiciliary care, care plan and incomplete, no nursing beds available, for example. All those things lead to delayed discharges. But you know, the report has been published and lessons are always learnt. And it's really, really important that trusts continue to do absolutely everything they can to avoid delayed discharges. And I think that they're certainly trying to do everything that they can. So there's new initiatives being looked at in relation to how they can do that. For example, can you have a discharge area where people move to? You know, and there's all sorts of issues. It could be family issues, people not being picked up in time. There's a whole raft of reasons. But I think it's important that we improve discharges so that we can allow the flow right across the hospital to be as most effective as possible, and that we're not blocking beds, and that staff are not frustrated at all of that. So I think that the Audit Office allows us to learn lessons. The Audit Office report allows us to learn lessons.
Supplementary for Roy Beggs.
The report also highlighted the need to enable GPs and other healthcare professions to provide more additional services locally. Would the Minister recognise the benefits of developing modern health and care and wellbeing centres in areas such as Larne and Carrickfergus, and what capital and resources are going to be committed to enable local GPs and other healthcare practitioners to deliver this?
And the Minister can choose which question to answer.
I think that it's really important that we invest in primary care. I think that very clearly what I set out last week or the week before in relation to delivering together and how we're going to plan services for the future, then we have to do that collectively and we have to do it holistically. We can't look at one element of the health service in the absence and out on its own. You have to look at the whole thing in the round. And I think that if we're going to be successful in dealing with blockages in hospital and increased numbers going into hospital, hospital should absolutely be the last port of call. Your service should be available in your local community. So in order to transform a system, then that's where we have to invest. And that's what I've clearly set out my stall in relation to the fact that I'm going to do that. I think it's only then that people can feel confident that the new ways of the new models and they feel ownership of the new models. Things like, for example, acute care at home, so allowing people to stay in their homes more, having the support they need in their home. We need to do a lot more of that. Invest in primary care, invest in our GPs, and I've clearly set out how I'm going to do that. We're going to have a named health visitor, social worker and district nurse in every, working with every GP practice. That changes the whole picture in relation to primary care. So we're not going to achieve all these things overnight, but I think with a fair win, with people really, really working together and being really true to partnership and collaboration, then I think we will see a very different picture in relation to primary care, and that's going to help the patient to achieve better outcomes. It's going to help avoiding unnecessary admissions to hospital, and it's going to obviously help them with the flow to our hospitals.
Iram Sir, Kiva Archibald. I call Kiva Archibald.
Margaret Peave, Leish Concolia. Can I ask the Minister when does she intend to go out for consultation on Professor Bengoa's criteria for service reconfiguration?
In the statement that I made to the Chamber on the 25th of October, I announced that I would publicly consult on the criteria, and the consultation will begin this week and run through to early January 2017. Patients, service users and all stakeholders will have the opportunity to submit their views in writing on the criteria. I've been encouraged, I have to say, with the positive response to my vision to date. Delivering Together has really received quite a lot of positive feedback, and I want to make sure that absolutely everyone has their say on the criteria for assessing the sustainability of health and social care services, which, if adopted by my department, will be at the heart of informing future decisions to be taken about reconfiguring HSE services. So I therefore urge everybody who has a stake in ensuring that we build a sustainable health and social care system will come and make sure that they respond to the consultation, make sure your views are heard, and I certainly will take all those views on board before finalising my department's future policy on the criteria as they stand.
Kiva Archibald for supplementary.
Can I thank the Minister for her response, and I think that is very positive, but can I just ask, will the consultation also include public meetings for people to make contributions in that way?
Yes, I'm going to do that as part of the process. There's going to be a series of public meetings. There'll be consultations right across the north, and that's, I think, going to be a real opportunity for people to put forward their views, as well as providing a forum to allow people to ask questions on the criteria and engage directly with the transformation team officials from my department. I'll release details of the consultation meetings, including venues and times, by the department by week commencing the 14th of November.
Éirim Sir Philip McGuigan. I call Philip McGuigan.
Margaret Prio, last Karen Collier, and can I just begin by apologising to yourself and the Minister for not being in my place earlier when I was called. Can I ask the Minister for her assessment of the potential for the Dalriada Pathfinder project and the Living Well in Moyle project in assisting community wellbeing and health for the people of Ballycastle and surrounding areas?
Well, can I say that I absolutely recognise the positive benefits of the Living Well model, with its focus on health and wellbeing outcomes for individuals, and also the role that the local community play in helping to achieve those outcomes. Living Well Moyle, which was established by the Dalriada Pathfinder Group, aims to improve people's health and wellbeing, improve their experience of health and social care, as well as reducing the cost of care and support. The pilot will employ a community navigator to work with service users to identify health and wellbeing outcomes. We will then work with the local community to identify how existing community resources can help achieve those outcomes. It's anticipated that the service will deliver both improved outcomes for people using the service, as well as savings to the HSE. This is exactly the type of project I want to see developed and explored. I want to see innovative new ways of working being tested. And where projects produce good outcomes for people using services, I want to see those scaled up. This is a key commitment in my vision for the HSE, and I intend to take that forward.
Philip McGuigan for a supplementary.
Can I thank the Minister for her enthusiastic endorsement of the project, and can I ask her if she intends to be at the launch later on this month?
Yes, I'm looking forward to attending the launch on, I think it's the 30th of November, and the aims, I think that the aims of the model, including prevention and the promotion of empowerment and wellbeing, are very much in line with the direction that we need to go in transforming the HSE, as I've outlined, in Delivering Together. I've always said that if something works well, then we should scale it up and we should do more of it. So I'm really looking forward to getting out to take a look for myself to see how effective this is, and also to listen to people and engage, because I think sometimes reading about something and then when you actually go deliver it or to visit and see for yourself, it actually comes alive a lot more.
I'm finding it a bit difficult to hear the Minister, so could I ask people to refrain from speaking or else leave the chamber. Can I call Robin Swan?
Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Minister, you were referring earlier on to all-island models of health. Paediatric cardiac surgery is already an agreed model for all-island health. Could you give me an update on how the $42 million that was announced on, I think was it the 4th of July this year, and how that's been spent?
Yes, and I know the member has a keen interest in the issue, and I think that obviously the announcement was a positive announcement, and it was something that allows families to stay on the island of Ireland whenever they need to have treatment. And often it's, you know, it's quite a significant surgery, and to have to leave your family and go to England and perhaps leave kids behind, it's really, really important that we do all we can to support those families. And I think this is a really practical example of all-island collaboration. I think there's a lot of good progress that's being made to establish the appropriate structures, and securing the necessary funds was obviously a key part of that. I'm also very conscious that we remain reliant on the majority of urgent and elective procedures for local children being carried out in England, so obviously we've got a few years actually till we get to full capacity. I think it's important that we continue to push forward the progress on the surgical side to allow us to have those surgeries on the island as quickly as possible. In the interim, obviously the Belfast Trust continue to operate at a service level agreement with Our Lady's Hospital in Dublin. I think that the progress is great. You mentioned the figure in relation to the spend to date. I don't know what that figure is off the top of my head, but I'm happy to provide that to the member. What I'm most interested here is that we get to full capacity as quickly as possible, and that nobody has to travel unnecessarily to receive the treatment. I just think, for me, I can only imagine as a parent what that would be like. So I think that we need to continue to push the project forward. It's a really good example of all-island collaboration, and I want to do a lot more of it to support families.
Robin Swan for supplementary.
I thank the Minister as a parent who's made that travel. Can I ask her, the capacity in Our Lady of Lourdes and Crumlin seems to be one of the limiting factors of getting this model up and running. Can she give us any update on how she's progressing that with Minister Harrison, when we can see the outcome?
I can, and I'll actually be in a better position to update the member after I meet with Minister Harris tomorrow, because this will be one of the areas which we're discussing at the NSMC, just in relation to progress to date and what are the challenges and what are the barriers. But we've set out our stall in relation to the phase basis, but yes, there are capacity issues in the hospital in Dublin. But I think that, I mean, that was all part of the plan. We knew that, and I think that as quickly as I can possibly get to the stage where we're providing full capacity on the island for families such as yourselves, then I think that'll be a true positive outcome for this. I'm committed to making sure that we do everything we can, and also working with the Children's Heartbeat Trust, because obviously there are families who all come together to actually talk about and share their experiences, and also to lobby for the service to happen. So I'll continue to keep in touch with the member in relation to this.
Éirim Sir Declan Kearney, and I call Declan Kearney for a very brief topical.
Minister, very briefly, could you give us an assessment of the mental ill health problems within our prison and our youth justice systems?
And can I give a very brief answer?
I'll try and summarise. I think that recent incidents underline the need to address the mental health problems that exist in our prisons. I've said that mental health is going to be a priority for me, and I'm considering a number of policy proposals. But perhaps in the interest of time, what I do, Can Corlia, is I'll write to the member to give him a more detailed breakdown in relation to the assessment.
I thank the Minister for her support in that. Time is up. That concludes question time. Point of order.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Could I ask that the Speaker might review the hazard of question time today? Some members were permitted to preface and contextualise their question with a couple of sentences without interruption. Some members managed it with interruption, and some of us were actually interrupted in the first sentence. So could I ask that the Speaker review hazard with a view to us having maybe more consistency in how these matters are dealt with? I think it's important to be able to contextualise questions, and that's why members right across the chamber do that.
I will certainly be asking the Speaker to review Hansard today. The member knows full well that Speaker's ruling is final on all questions of procedure and order, and that when in this chair, Deputy Speakers and Principal Deputy Speaker have the same authority. So let us move on.
Deputy Speaker.
Point of order.
Thank you. Principal Deputy Speaker, you may be aware of an increasing perception that the Executive of this Assembly will do whatever it can to evade the accountability of this Assembly. It is, I presume, the role of the Speaker to assist us to achieve such accountability, so I am at a total loss as to why the Speaker rejected my request for an urgent oral question from response from the Education Minister on what action he has taken to avert teacher industrial action in our community at the Assembly today. We have the bizarre situation where the Education Minister has given interviews to the media in the Great Hall of this building, but no statement to the Assembly on this urgent issue.
Can I ask the Speaker? Can I interrupt the member, please? The decision on urgent oral questions is a matter for the Speaker. It's not an order to challenge them. Now, let us move.
Principal Deputy Speaker, could I request some guidance with regards to what constitutes an urgent oral question, given I can see no more urgent issue than the one facing our schools at this moment in time?
The member is very aware, and an experienced member of this House, and the member is very aware that all he needs to do is go to the business office, which is very accessible. Now, let us move on. That concludes question time. We will now return to the debate on ending paramilitarism, when I will put the question on the motion as amended.